this side had a big stick with a rag at the end and a barrel, and this one had a big stick at the end, and you had to hold your arm like this, and he speared you under the armpit. Then you had to bend down and spread your cheeks, smear your rectum and the groins, and that stuff stunk to high heaven. This was supposedly a disinfectant. And we were sent to the bathhouse. And I didn't know what kind of bath we are going to be exposed to. But fortunately, it was water that came down, hot water, and there was a good shower and so on. After we finished showering, they put us into a barrack and told us to sit on our rears with the knees bent fully and spread out, so the next guy will sit right in your crouch. And a assessment with a whip was standing there and hitting you to squeeze in, squeeze in, squeeze in. I didn't think I could possibly survive this. My testicles became like scrambled eggs as the guy was squeezing into me. And my knees and my hips were hurting for being bent and spread out. The place was packed with all us prisoners. Fortunately, this didn't last very long, no more than about a half hour. They told us to get up, and we went to another barrack. Mind you, this is all winter, and we run to the next barrack. In the next barrack, they had a pile of shirts, probably from victims that they killed, a pile of them. And they had a pile of jackets, striped ones, and a pile of slacks, striped ones, and piles of shoes. Large, small, wooden shoes. And we had to go very fast because the guy was going there with his whip to pick up a jacket, pick up a shirt. Fortunately, they beat you with the whip. You had to go fast. So I grabbed probably somebody's nightgown and it reached to my ankles. But I had no choice, that's what I got. A jacket, then striped one, striped slacks, and a pair of shoes, but they didn't fit. So the prisoners afterwards kept exchanging what they got. Now, we were then sent to a barrack where we were supposed to live. And it was cold and no food. And I developed, I'm not going to tell you in English, gastroenteritis, my stomach with diarrhea. And there wasn't even a shred of paper in the latrine. The latrine was a large latrine with holes where all the prisoners were going to. And here I had diarrhea, and God, how am I going to survive this? And no paper to wipe myself. Well, fortunately, I had this large shirt, so I kept tearing off stripes of that shirt to wipe myself, to clean myself. It was a horrible experience. I will never forget that. But I survived it. And a few days later, they shipped us to Mr. Schindler's camp in Berlin. Niemiec in Czech, and Brünnlitz Brissau in German, a small town where he had was moving his factory from Krakow to there. And there we were set up in a big building, and I and one gentleman from Krakow were supposed to be set up with the glaziers. But there was nothing to glaze there. We were set up in a shop that had no windows. The door was a metal door, and it was off the courtyard. And if you walked there, you wouldn't even have noted there was anything there. We were assigned there. There were some plates of glass there to work with, and that's where we were supposed to work. In the morning, we stood in line to get breakfast. The breakfast was what is called ersatz coffee. It wasn't coffee. It was brown wheat or some other grain that had been roasted. Everybody wanted to get some of the roasted grains. But there was a long line of us trying to get food, and the guys who were dishing out the food had their friends. So their friends got the grains, and I got the water. So I had brown water. They gave us one small piece of bread, no bigger than this. And I thought that's for breakfast, so I ate it, only to find out that that's supposed to last all day. You didn't get any bread anymore. For lunch, supposedly we stood in line for soup. The soup was the beet soup. That was water with beets in it. And again, the guys who were dishing out the soup gave the beets to their friends from the bottom. All I got was maroon water. And I want you to know, when I urinated maroon. Luckily, I knew it wasn't blood. It was maroon, the urine. And that went on for days, like this. Fortunately, Mrs. Schindler came, and she arranged with a lady, a friend of hers, a countess. Her name was Countess Daubeck, D-A-U-B-E-C-K, a German countess that owned a flour mill. And they arranged to get a little extra flour for us. And soon, this little piece of bread grew a little bigger. And we got then one eighth of a loaf, a small loaf, to 1/6, and occasionally 1/4. So we had gradually better food. The best food there that I had is I developed a severe toothache. So I went to the dispensary, and there were two Jewish dentists there. And while I was there, Mrs. Schindler brought a pot of soup from her home, and I got a bowl of soup. That was the first decent soup I had at Schindler's. I reminded her after the war, and I called her. She was in Argentina, at San Vicente in Argentina, and she was coming to New York to be interviewed by the BBC. So I, from Chicago, flew to New York to meet her. And I reminded her of the soup that really was so wonderful that I had when I was there. But it was was difficult to get food enough to satiety. Here and there, there would be a piece of horse meat there, but again, since I was a nobody there, I was not from Krakow. Most of the people were from Krakow, so they had their favorite people that you may have seen in Schindler's List. They got the piece of meat that was in a bowl. I just got the water. So, but anyway, I survived it there. Then was coming to the end of the war. The America's Patton's Army was to the west of that place where I was. The Soviet Army was to the east of us, right then and there. The question was, who's going to come into our camp first? The Soviets or the Americans? Mr. Schindler took some of his favorite people, Jewish people, who used to be prominent in the Zionist organization in Krakow, and he took them westward. The Germans were scared to death of Soviets. All they wanted to be taken prisoners by Americans, because the Americans gave them food and treated them decently. So he took them west, and there was nobody in the camp. The SS disappeared, except for a few oldsters that remained there from what were called the Volkssturm. The Volkssturm was, when they were losing the war, Goebbels, the propaganda minister, called on all the oldsters to grab weapons and to children to grab weapons, because they were still, according to them, able to win the war. It was stupidity itself. The Soviets were in Berlin, you know, the Americans were to the west of Berlin. It was ridiculous. But they thought, and Hitler was dreaming that he still has armies that can fight and so on. So anyway, we were stuck in Brinnlitz. The SS disappeared except for some oldsters who were completely harmless. They wanted to preserve what they were doing with guns. They wanted to go home. Anyway, so there was, we were in no man's land for a while. And I remember I walked out on the plaza. I wasn't anymore afraid of anything. And all of a sudden, I see some uniformed people along the perimeter of the camp marching. And I thought those were probably our liberators. It wasn't. All of a sudden, we are being machine gunned. And I didn't know what it was. I dropped to the ground. I wasn't hit. Some people were hit. These were actually Ukrainian volunteers that fought with the German army. And they didn't want to be taken by the Russians, because that would have been the end of them. And as they were marching by, they shot at us. Anyway, I survived that. And then, about a day later, a young Russian soldier on a horse marches into the camp. And people start surrounding him, and he is actually a Soviet soldier. And we knew that we are now free. Then a general came, a Soviet general. He wanted us to write a letter to Stalin, thanking him for it and all that sort of stuff. And to make a long story short, I didn't go to the West. I made my way back home. I didn't know where to go, but I wanted to find out whether anyone by miracle survived and who. So I made my way. It was almost impossible to get home because bridges were all bombed out, trains weren't going. But one way or another, I managed to get back to my hometown outside, not in my town, because the railroad station was bombed. There was no way to get into town. So in the village, I got off and I worked my way back, and I found out there was no one alive, but there was one lady with a little daughter that was alive and two sisters, all of whom were hidden during the war, and they told me their story. And that lady with the child allowed me to stay there, and I stayed there. And she made a living by selling wet Hungarian cigarettes to the taverns there. So I took over the job. I went to sell two cigarettes here to really give her the money, you know, and I stayed with her. And she told me her survival story, which was unbelievable. Unbelievable how she was hidden in a double wall in a stable. And then the police was coming and told her where someone must have given away that she's hiding a Jewess. He is hiding a Jewess. They were beating him. She could hear it through the double wall. They were beating him to tell her where the Jewess is. And he would not. So the son and he was hitting him, took her to the forest, dug a hole in the forest, put the woman and the baby in that hole, and covered it with branches and leaves. And once a week he would bring some bread and water to her. That's how she survived. She told me that story. She did not intend to stay in Poland. Neither did I, because it was communist Poland. I didn't even register, because if I had registered, as I returned, I would have to be put into the army. And I was not interested to go into the army and so on. Anyway, I made my way west. I can tell you a long story. Landed up in jail in Czechoslovakia, being accused of being a Polish spy, the Czechs, sitting in jail and so on. I got out of there, and we managed to eventually get to the west, to Bavaria. And I went to a displaced person camp with an uncle of mine who survived in Buchenwald, and he was liberated by Patton's army, and there they got all kinds of goodies, care packages, cigarettes, American cigarettes, and all kinds of conserved salami, coffee, all kinds that you couldn't get in Poland. You could have bought a house with a package of cigarettes, of American cigarettes, almost. And he came to look for relatives and didn't find any. So he found me. And he told me, you're not going to stay here. You're going to go back to the American zone. That's where they have all kinds of charitable organizations. There are Quakers, there are Jewish, there are Christian charitable organizations. That's where we are going. And we smuggled our way. And it's a long, long story there. And we were there. And there we were getting every day a nice breakfast, lunch, dinner. There, for the first time, I tasted ketchup. And I loved ketchup because I dipped my bread in ketchup, and I thought, well, I think that man who invented ketchup ought to get the Nobel Prize. But the food was very good, but I now sobered up. I was free. Now what am I going to do? Am I going to be a glazier? know, where am I going to go? I want to go to the United States. And I don't want to be a Galician. I want to study. And I would give an arm and a leg to study, no matter what it is. I couldn't care less, just had to be studied. I had to study, period. And I did. Eventually, when the medical school opened, before it opened, I was going to architectural school to be an architect. I know as much about architecture as you know flying jets. No, but anything that's an education, I would have taken and wanted. Eventually, I got to medical school. I graduated there, came to the U.S., joined the Army during the Korean War, and I was assigned to the medical corps with the rank of first lieutenant. Then I became a captain, and now all of a sudden I got rich, because as an intern in the hospital, I was making $40 a month. And I had to buy clothes, shoes, stockings, and have any of it. And I wasn't one to go and take alms or take somebody's donations. I was going to earn this myself. And in the Army, I got wealthy because I got $200 a month. Wow. I was really rich. So I bought for $25 a suit at the Robert Hall store. I don't know whether you guys know Robert Hall, you know, and so on. Now I was elegant. And I graduated, I married my wife, had children. Then after the service, I joined the medical school. I was a full-time faculty. And there I was making $4,800 a year. And when I wanted more, I was told, well, the full professor was making only 8 and 12. Why should we give you more? Anyway, I went into private practice, but I was still on the faculty. And I worked hard, I saved, but I was making $40. I was saving a couple of dollars. And when I was making 90 as a resident a month, I was saving some money. And at the age of 75, in 1997, I decided it's time to quit while you're ahead, and I moved here where it's nice and warm, so I won't be exposed to the frost the way you were a few days ago here. And that's where I've been since that time. And one of the things that I do, aside some medical stuff, that I still have a case to do, but I'm retiring at the age of 95, and I'm not going to be doing any more of those. But I do speak to schools, and what I like to convey to them, the message from my experience that I just described to you. Number one, World War II and the Holocaust didn't have to occur, could have easily been avoided. But why did it happen? Well, I'm not a researcher, and I'm not a journalist, and I'm not a historian, so I like a simple answer. The simple answer for what I saw was indifference. Germans are not killers. They don't go around shooting Jews. You heard most Germans at the air base were extremely nice, and that I worked with. But they were indifferent. They could see very easily, in the 30s, Hitler killing his own children, handicapped killing his own handicapped people, and then throwing Jews out of their homes, of their stores, not in the windows. All you had to do is open the window and see it. But that didn't bother them. No one marched. Germany had plenty of Nobel Prize winners. Not a woman ever marched. So that, I hope, cannot happen in the United States, where people march even for the unborn, for an embryo. So you hope that you will tell people about it, that indifference is a horrible thing, and your children and grandchildren should all watch out for it and not remain indifferent to what they see, a group of people being sequestered out, either because of the color of the skin or because of their religion or otherwise, or because they have long hair, or because they color their hair, or whatever not, and they are different, or because they want to marry another man. That's their private problem. This is should be a free country, and if you see something that happen, you should protest it and join protesters and scream bloody murder. Hopefully, it will never happen in the United States. So indifference is the first thing, I think, the major lesson of the Holocaust that you should tell your children. Because it can happen again if you don't remember history. The next thing is, my dad's, be a mensch. Be a decent human being. That means don't paint graffiti on people's houses, don't throw garbage on the street where somebody else has to clean it up, don't join skinheads, neo-Nazis, and all kinds of such radical organizations that are inhuman, because it can lead to what you heard me tell you about. And if it happened in Germany, it can happen anywhere, because they were the most highest educated people in Europe. They were highly civilized, highly industrialized, Western nation, and it happened. And the third thing is, even if you go through such trauma as I went through, and I look at my trauma being relatively mild, of what I have friends, what they went through. Because fortunately, my father was a glazier, glass worker, and they needed us. So they were treated relatively better. And at the air base, we worked there, we were treated humanely. Then I was a Schindler's List in his camp, and there I was also treated relatively humanely. So I didn't suffer as much as some who were shipped to Auschwitz. I was never in Auschwitz. Gross Rosen was the worst one, and Chevnya that I was in, and Krakow-Płaszów. But they were all short term. So even if you've suffered severe trauma, to be a mensch, make yourself a mensch out of it, means don't quit studying. If you don't want for the rest of your life to flip hamburgers at McDonald's, you better not give up studying. No matter what, if you study a subject and you have a diploma in your pocket, you can go anywhere and you will survive. If you don't have it, all you can do is flip hamburgers at $7 an hour, and then thank your senator that he increased you by 25 cents an hour or 50 cents an hour.